Hey everybody, my name's Luca, and since I have been home from university for holiday break, I decided to start getting up at sunrise and doing what I love to do most, which is wildlife photography. And because of my extra time, I also wanted to make some videos to share my experiences, offer up some tips, so that if you're interested in photography or nature photography specifically, you can enjoy my videos and maybe learn something along the way. So the day after I arrived home, I decided to get up real early, right before sunrise, and just try to do some wildlife photography around my local park. I wanted to do this to just kind of illustrate how much wildlife is really around us everywhere we go. The place I shot at was literally not even 100 feet away from my house, so I thought it would be cool to see what animals are living right in my local area. For this shoot and all my wildlife shoots, I was using my Nikon D750, which I'm filming this on right now, as well as my Tamron 100-400. I absolutely adore this lens. There's not really another better affordable option that gives you the reach that this lens does, as well as the sharpness and overall performance. Now, when I first got up, I realized that the conditions weren't really the best for photography. It was really overcast and there wasn't even a sunrise. But nonetheless, I decided to go out and get the best pictures I could, and I'm really happy with what I was able to capture. And now I'm gonna show you my best photos that I was able to get that morning, just to kind of illustrate that you don't have to travel too far, you don't have to have the most expensive gear, and you don't really even need the best lighting to get amazing shots. Now, obviously, if you decided to go to a better location, you had better lighting, and you had better gear, would your shots be sharper? Would they be better? Yeah, probably. But I think it's important to not get too discouraged by not having the best gear, not shooting the best conditions, because what really matters in wildlife photography is proper planning and proper knowledge of the subjects that you're shooting. So with that being said, let's take a look at some of those shots.
The weather this morning was overcast and dreary. The clouds in the sky diffused the sun's light and provided some really flat and even lighting over my neighborhood lake, as well as all the critters that I would find. Not quite the spectacular sunrise that us wildlife photographers are hoping for, but nonetheless, I made my way to the local park, just a couple hundred feet away from my house, to see what kind of wildlife I could find. This crow was the first animal I found hanging out on my local park, and he decided to perch himself on top of some of the signs he saw there. Maybe he's actually the 24-hour video surveillance that's being advertised. I mean, I see a lot of people complaining that birds aren't real and they're just surveillance drones, so maybe by sitting on top of the sign, he's kind of revealing his hand here. I definitely better watch my moves around this guy. In the lake, two female mallards were wading through the water, and it looks like one is kind of mad at the other mallards that are out of frame, or maybe she's just warning them that some scary man with a camera decided to show up. And at this point in the shoot, I was shooting in very, very dim lighting conditions. I did brighten this up quite a bit in post, but I was already shooting at a very high ISO, so I decided not to push it too much further. Although I could have warmed up this image a little bit more as well, I decided to keep the blue tones to kind of stay true to the early morning lighting. As the sun began to rise behind the clouds, the lighting began to improve a little bit, and I was gladly able to lower my D750's ISO, which is always a welcome addition for any nature photographers who are constantly trying to struggle against their camera's high ISO performance. Now, most of the time I see a squirrel when I'm out shooting, I decided to skip over them, but this guy allowed me to get really close, and this shot is actually completely uncropped, and it just goes to show that even when shooting in not the best lighting conditions, if you're able to get close to your subjects, even with a 400mm at 6.3, you can really blow out the background and get that beautiful bokeh that really blows out those yellow, greenish leaves in the background. So this female yellow-rumped warbler, who is a part of the myrtle subspecies, as I'm shooting on the east coast of the US, decided to perch herself on a nearby branch. In the winter, these birds love to rummage around shrubs and look for berries, and in the summertime, they really like to go out and catch bugs, but obviously because of the weather conditions, this time of the year in the winter, that's a little bit harder for them to do. So here the 24-hour surveillance drone decided to patrol around the playground, and because it was so early in the morning, this crow actually had the park to himself and was just happily strutting about. Normally in wildlife photography, you want there to be the most limited amount of human-made objects in the frame, but I tried to actually embrace the opposite in that shot and show this crow just chilling around the playground where there's normally a bunch of human children running around instead. I spotted this cute little blue jay foraging around the edge of the park near this bench. I decided to get really low for the shot and try to capture this blue jay at eye level. I wish I could have gotten closer, as I could have gotten some really great compression with the foreground grass and just the background being the blown out lake, but I'm still really happy with the shot. And again, kind of like what I was saying earlier, I decided to incorporate this park bench in my framing and kind of tell the story of these birds hanging out around the local park near all these human-made items that people are normally using. This adult female Baltimore oriole was rummaging through the leaves above me as she was looking for fibers that she can use to build her hanging nest. And it looks like she's found some here in this leaf. You can see these white little fibers in between the brown leaves, and these are going to be really crucial for this oriole to build her habitat for her and her family. Now, this is one of my favorite shots of the whole day. I love that I was able to capture the water droplet hanging out on this leaf, as well as the Baltimore oriole in this really curious position, and we get to see both of her eyes in this shot as she's inspecting more leaves just so she can get more materials to build her home. Capturing the expressions of these unique animals is really what wildlife photography is all about, and I'm thrilled for this shot. And here's that yellow rumped warbler again, this time standing on top of a table, peering up into the sky. And again, I love that I was able to capture these water droplets hanging from the underneath of this table. Now, sometimes it's annoying to stroll through some muddy grass, but I think these little details that having rained the night before adds can give your wildlife photography images a lot more character. And this warbler was not very shy and let me get really close to her. And I love the effect I was able to get at 400 millimeters, really just blowing out the background and just getting another great shot of these animals hanging out some of the park amenities, this time just chilling on top of a picnic table. And what is this bird? Prior to this day, I never actually saw one of these guys before, but there's actually a pretty easy giveaway, and boom, there it is. That bright red spot on the back of their necks means that this is a male northern flicker, and these are actually some woodpeckers, but they love to hang out on the ground. And although he's hanging out on the ground here, a couple days after, I actually saw probably this exact bird on a neighbor's tree, so I'll show you that image right there. And there you can just see a lot different lighting conditions on this day, all that golden light really peering through those nice leaves. This adult northern mockingbird struck a really nice pose on top of my neighbor's hedge and allowed me to capture a great portrait of them. And you can actually see my neighbor's house blown out in the background, which isn't traditional to wildlife photography, but because of the distance I was able to get to this animal, it doesn't distract too much from the subject here. And as these beautiful mallards are flying above the tree line of the lake, this brown thrasher is enjoying some blue-colored berries for a nice early morning breakfast. And as this bird moves throughout the bush, I was able to capture some great portraits of them with some different head positionings. And you can see here in these first two shots, the leaves are kind of covering up some of the parts of the bird that I want to make sure are in my photograph. But in this third shot here, we can see a great head position from the bird that shows off the berry that they have in their mouth and aren't obstructed by any leaves too much by the face. And this goes to show that in wildlife photography, it's really important to make sure that you are moving yourself in the right position to try to peer through the leaves when you're shooting in these brush-like conditions. But it's also really important to just make sure your autofocus point is on your subject and just firing away sometimes, being mindful of your camera's buffer capacity, of course, but you just can't control the behavior of these animals. So it's important to just get a lot of shots to work with. And then when you're going back and editing, you can find that one perfect shot where the animal's just in the ideal position for you to capture that great image. Now, just a small movement of this bird throughout the bush just allows me to capture such a drastically different image. Now, the lighting in the shot is absolutely amazing. I love the tones from the greenish, yellow, and brown leaves, and I love the expression that this bird is giving me. I mean, look at that bright yellow, beady eye, simply gorgeous. But it actually looks like this thrasher is quite angry at me now, or maybe they're just yawning after enjoying a nice blue-colored berry for breakfast. After doing some research, turns out that these thrashers are actually known to attack dogs or humans who encroach on their nests and have even drawn blood from them in some cases. So if you're ever observing a brown thrasher, just make sure you're keeping some safe distance, which is always a good rule of thumb in wildlife photography. It's best not to disturb your subjects because you avoid any violent confrontations, but it's also great to just kind of let these creatures be. It's good for the overall ecosystem and allows you to capture more natural shots of what these animals would be doing, even if nobody was there taking a picture of them. Now, as this brown thrasher hops down from this bush, it digs its beak into the forest floor below and looks like it has some mud on there now. Maybe that's just how they brush their teeth in the morning after breakfast, but I doubt it, because this bird is still hungry. Over half their diet comes from insects, and they will not hesitate to send pine needles and sticks flying all over the place until they find their next meal. Now, in this shot, I was shooting at a really high ISO because the sun wasn't really up yet. It was still behind the clouds, and the lighting that was there was heavily covered by the trees above, but I was able to apply a good amount of noise reduction to the background. And although it would have been nice for the thrasher to kind of be framed against the green background so the subject really pops out, I kind of like these more camouflage shots because, I mean, if you kind of squint and take a step back, it's really actually hard to see the bird there. It's incredible how much these birds have evolved to fit into the background of their habitat, and just goes to show why bird photography is so difficult yet rewarding. Now, while the thrasher continues to rummage around for food, this double-crested cormorant swims through the beautiful greens and yellows that the morning light is reflecting into the lake. And I really love the crop I got in this shot. That white reflecting below them is actually the reflection of a house. And it kind of would have been nice for the shot to be completely green and yellow, but I kind of like that nice pop that the white house reflection gives there. Now, in my other neighbor's backyard, what I'm pretty sure is a juvenile song sparrow sits perched on some nice foliage here. And I kind of like that there's this bush in the left-hand side of the foreground. Now, because I am shooting with a 100 to 400 lens, not one of the pro big primes, I kind of have to frame these images as if they're environmental portraits because of my limited reach and higher aperture. So I kind of like the way that the twigs and bush here is framed. It shows the habitat that this animal is living in, and I think that's something that's really cool to capture in wildlife photography. And for my final image here, a female cardinal looks down at me from on top of my neighbor's gutter. And normally when I'm out doing wildlife photography, as I mentioned before, there aren't any human-made objects in the frame. And I really like that I was able to capture lots of great images of wildlife being in not-so-wild conditions, because it shows that although these birds are completely wild, they are from nature, they kind of adapt and exist in the world we live in, and it's cool to see all the life that exists in what we consider our human world. So yeah, I hope these shots inspired you to go out in your own local neighborhood and see what kind of critters are lurking around there.
So those were my best shots, and I hope you all enjoyed the video. Some of my favorite shots were definitely the ones I got of that Baltimore oriole as she was looking for some fibers in order to build her nest. I love to capture all the unique behaviors and expressions that these animals provide. I also really love the shots I got of that thrasher. I highly recommend anyone interested in wildlife photography to just get up real early one morning and check out your local area. You might be surprised what kind of wildlife you'll be able to find. I get that not everyone lives near a nice park and a lake, but there's wildlife everywhere, especially birds. They're very adaptable creatures, and I'm sure that your location has some unique species that a lot of people who live there don't even notice. Normally, when you get up super early, there's nobody else around, so you can kind of just be one with the birds and get a lot closer and capture their more unique behaviors because there's less hustling, bustling noise going on everywhere. Let me know what your favorite shot was for the shoot, and stay tuned because I have a couple more videos up in the works. I've been really happy with the shots I've been able to get on my sunrise shoots. So this is the first video of many. So please hit the subscribe button, like the video, share it with your friends, and let me know if you have any suggestions for future videos, such as editing tips and just other general wildlife photography, videography related things. So yeah, I hope you enjoyed, and I will see you next time. Peace.